Continue. And what he gives is always immeasurably less than he promises, which is the truth. You know what I mean? Look at Bill Cosby now, you know what I mean? Like, he had all that money and fame, and I don't feel, like I said, any sympathy for him because he's still living better than me. Recently, I was just homeless for years, you know what I mean? So, you know, like I said, that man might be in prison, but that man still, he ain't in no real prison. He's in, like, a fucking resort, you know what I'm saying? And what's that scripture that talks about a good name? You know, as talented as that man is, he will never be remembered for his talent. He'll be remembered for being a pedophile. So the gifts that he gave him, he took back and took more so back. He took his good name, you know. For Yahweh Shah to have given in to this third temptation would have brought the same ultimate result as his having succumbed to either of the other two. He would have disqualified himself not only as king but as savior. Statement of those who mocked at the foot of the cross would have had to have been reversed. He saved himself. Others he cannot save. See Matthew 27:42. Instead of redeeming the world, he would have joined the world. Instead of inheriting the world, he would have lost the world. Mashiach would have played the Antichrist, and the Lamb would have become the beast. As before, Yahushua replied was from Scripture, and it is again from Deuteronomy. Then Yahushua said to him, "Get thee hence, Shantan, for it is written, Thou shalt worship the Lord thy power, and him only shalt thou serve." The tempter's last proposal was so preposterous that Yahushua dismissed him with, "Be gone, Satan." The devil had stepped beyond all bounds in proposing such unutterable wickedness because Satan's present power is only by God's permission. When the Son commanded him to leave, Satan had no choice but to obey. Therein Christ demonstrated the very sovereign power Satan wanted him to misuse. The Son of Yahweh would not compromise even the least important truth in the universe. He would surely not compromise the greatest, that Yahweh and Yahweh alone is to be worshipped and served. Yahweh had heard enough from the enemy, though Satan would be back as soon as he had an opportune time. Luke 4:13, for now he was forced to leave. Yahweh will inherit the kingdom in Yahweh's time, and we will inherit the kingdom with him. Matthew 5:5, Matthew 25:34, Romans 8:17, James 2:5. In the eternal heavenly state, all the universe will be ours. Who will want to sacrifice that for the deceptive, disappointment, and short-lived imitations Satan offers? There are many good things that Yahweh will give us even in this life. No one desires our happiness more than our Heavenly Father. If you then, being evil, Yahweh says, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your Father who is in heaven give what is good to those who ask him? Matthew 7:11. We can have the happiness Yahweh gives. Why should we settle for the cheap substitute Satan offers? We can have the success of living righteously and pleasing our Heavenly Father. Why should we settle for the brief and disappointing successes sin produces? By Yahweh's grace, we can have the peace that passes understanding. Why should we settle for the cheap satisfaction that everyone understands but that will soon pass? It's a subtitle, The Triumph. Matthew 4:11. Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. When Yahushua said, "Be gone," the devil left him because he had no choice. The Lord gives all his children the power to resist Satan. Resist the devil, James assures us, and he will flee from you. James 4:7. As he did with Yahushua, Satan will not long stay away from us. But with every temptation, Yahweh will provide a way of escape. 1 Corinthians 10:13. For every temptation Satan leads us into, a way out is provided by the Father, which is so true. Satan's temptation failed, but Yahweh's testing succeeded. Yahweh's response to the tempter were in essence I will trust the Father. I will not presume on his word. I will not circumvent his will. I will take the Father's good gift from the Father's own hand, in the Father's own way, and in the Father's own time. Thus the king was accredited by the severest test. After Satan left, angels came. How much better is the ministry of angels than the deceptions of Satan? As Yahushua's baptism, the Father acknowledged Yahushua's work worthiness by proclaiming, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am pleased." Now the Father acknowledges Yahushua's worthiness by sending angels to minister to him. At any time during his wilderness experience, Yahushua could have asked for and received the aid of more than 12 legions of angels. Matthew 26:53. But he waited for his Father to send them in his Father's time. We are not told what the ministry of the angels included, but surely they brought Yahushua food to satisfy his hunger. We know they could not have been in the presence of the Son of Yahweh without offering him worship. And certainly they could not have come from heaven without bringing strengthening words of assurance and love from his Father. Satan tempts us in the same basic ways he tempted Yahushua in the wilderness. First, he would try to get us to distrust Yahweh's providential care and try to solve our problems, win our struggles, and meet our needs by our own plans and in our own power. And that's so true, because that's a big thing that I have trouble with, and it's true. You know, I trust the Most High, but then, you know, every once in a while, I go into trying to lean on my own understanding when, you know, if you really got all faith and trust in the Most High, you know, you might be, like, I can only speak for myself. I know it's times I'll be wondering, like, why is this? When, if you fully trust, you ain't going to question it. And that's something that I battle with. But hopefully the Lord is going to strengthen my spirit so I can have more faith to, don't second guess it. That ain't the exact word I want to. Yeah, but it's not doubt. It's more like questioning. I wouldn't say doubt or second guess. It's questioning. It ain't for me to question. Second, he will try to get us to presume on God's care and forgiveness by willingly putting ourselves in the way of danger, whether physical, economic, moral, spiritual, or any other. Third, he will appeal to selfish ambitions and try to get us to use our own schemes to fulfill the promises Yahweh has made to us, which amount to trying to fulfill God's plan in Satan's way. Those three ways are reflected in 1 John 2:16. For all that is in the world, that's the spirit, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes, and the boastful part of life is not from the Father, but it's from the world. The temptation for Yahushua to turn stones into bread was to fulfill the lust of the flesh by using his divine powers for selfish means. The temptation to throw himself off the pinnacle of the temple was to fulfill the lust of the eyes by showing off to the world and seeking fame through sensationalism. The temptation to grab immediate control of the kingdom of the world was to satisfy the boastful pride of life by yielding to Satan's power and will. The story is told of a man who was trying to teach his dog obedience. He would take a large piece of meat and put it in the middle of the floor. Each time the dog attempted to take the meat, the man would swat the dog and say no. Soon the dog began to associate the swatting with the word no and learned to stop simply when the word was said. When meat was placed on the floor, the dog would not look at it, but rather at his master, waiting for the word of approval or denial. That is essentially the message Yahweh teaches in this passage. When temptation comes, don't look at the temptation, but at Yahusha Mashiach. Keep your eyes on his example. I like that. When temptation, I'm going to repeat that. That is essentially the message Yahweh teaches in this passage. When temptation comes, don't look at the temptation, but at Yahusha Mashiach, because he endured and overcame, and we can overcome. I believe that's in like one of the first Johns, you know what I mean? Let me try and find that, because this is almost over with anyway. We can overcome. There you go. It's 1 John 5:4. I'm going to read from King James. For whatsoever is born of Yahweh overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. So, like I said, Yahweh Shai overcame and endured and overcame temptation, and being that he's our high priest and he's an example unto us, we are supposed to be able to endure and overcome. Continuing. Keep your eyes on his example and do what he did. Look at the ways he was tempted and at the way he resisted, and learn from him. The writer of Hebrews, perhaps with Yahweh Shai, wilderness temptation, particularly in mind, tells us, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our own weaknesses, but one who has been tempted in all things as we are, yet without sin. So he was tempted in all the same ways that we as men in this flesh get tempted, but he did not sin. And that was Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15. Even more encouraging is the earlier declaration, for since he himself was tempted in that which he has suffered, he is able to come to the aid of those who are tempted. Hebrews 2:18. Yahweh Shai has been there before us. He has met the worst Satan can give and has been victorious. More than that, he is eager to share the victory with his own people when they are tempted. No temptation has overtaken you, but such as is common to man. And Yahweh is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will provide the way of escape also, that you may be able to endure it. 1 Corinthians 10:13. We can have victory over temptation only by resisting in the way that Yahweh Shai resisted, by holding with complete obedience to Yahweh, by Yeshem Yahweh Shai and his word. Yahweh Shai endured temptation to the very limit of Satan's power, and he resisted to that very limit. He did not in the least degree allow temptation to develop in desire, much less into sin. James 1:13, James 1:13-15. He did not think the matter over or give it any consideration. He simply stood firmly in his father's will and said no. We find help against temptation just as we find help for everything else in the Christian life by fixing our eyes on Yahweh Shai, the author and perfecter of our faith. Hebrews 12:2. This is a spiritual little page right here, because everything I was saying is coming out right here. A hurdler soon learns that if he looks at the hurdles as he runs, he will trip and fall. From start to finish, if he looks only at the goal, and when he does that, the hurdles are cleared in stride as each one is encountered. Keeping our eyes on our Lord, Yahweh Shai, Mashiach, is our only hope of conquering temptation and faithfully running with endurance the race that is set before us. Hebrews 12:1. That's a beautiful little page, like I said. That last little subtitle, text part, I'll say it was two pages. But with that, I hope that lesson was somewhat edifying. That was chapter 8, so Lord will, I'm going to start chapter 9, hopefully next week. But if the Spirit moving me, I may start it before then. So with that, I want to give all praise, honor, and glory to Yahweh, Bahashim, Yahweh Shah, Bahashim, Racha Kodash Barakatham. Double honors to the apostles and elders of Great Millstone. Peace and salutations to the Akim around the four corners of the earth, pushing the truth with faith and sincerity. Once again, Shalom, Shalom to the hopeful elect. Shalom to the Salaki Akim and Akwath out there listening and learning. Once again, Shalom to all my fellow laborers. And with that, Adonwan Razazai, get to do another lesson next week. And with that, Shalom, and a ball.